How y'all doing tonight?
Yeah, we're good.
Pretty good. Pretty good. Excited to be here. So I won't need the mic the whole night. I'm just use it for the song. So you can play it real quick.
Okay.
Oh, you gotta take off the bass.
Oh, okay.
My bad. I gotta tell you that. So this song right here, I'll finish it real quick. It's called What If, and just trying to get, I wrote this song last year, and I recorded it this year. And the concept of the song is like just talking about what if, you know, how most of the time we get caught in the mindset of like, man, what if we get so pessimistic with the concept of what if, like, man, what if I would have done this? What if I would have done that? What if things had gone differently? But I'm trying to like alter our mindset to thinking, what if I was made for greatness? What if God was real? What if I can do something different with my life? What if there was a different meaning for my the reason why I'm living, you know, so get into that mindset.
Amen.
You play. I wanna do more than retire with savings. There's more than like what I see and what we're making. Hey, keep that passion ignited, the fire burning deep inside me. Any difference makes a person go and live it on purpose. You see me getting out of work and I'm trying to grow as a person. The struggle still will be over, and the end will be worth it. I know that I was meant to be so much more. Anybody talking down to me, I'll send a flood. I'm able to be everything I'm meant to be. Been stuck in the mindset, wondering what created for greatness. What if I went, gave it my best here? What if I had more living in me? No, tell me what I do, I can change a life. What if I was created for greatness? What if I went, gave it my best here? What if I had more living in me? No, tell me what I do, I can change a life. The sky is the limit, don't live in me with that mess. Galaxies of opportunities are out there. Only limits are the ones that sell me. This place that comes by giving, I pray that you give it to me. Back to that man standing right in that mirror. Hey, that's you in that mirror. The world was flipping it like a body that knows it. Only I can go in by drinking Red Bull. What kind of man will I be flying away from issues? Take a sip with a hand, you might escape for a bit. That is never giving Jack. Where you have been, check out the traction. And I've been burning away all distractions. Drinking beyond my imagination with the spirit of airline. Don't be able to stop us, don't pursue what you must. Change what truly matters. No matter who I need to panic. And I'm on it like Sonic, I know that I'm here. Created for greatness. What if I went, gave it my best here? What if I had more living in me? No telling what I do, I can change a life. What if I was created for greatness? What if I went, gave it my best here? What if I had more living in me? No telling what I do, I can change a life. What if I quit with my complaining? What if I gave more thanksgiving? What if I changed the time I'm spending? I use this thing like my life's all count. What if I quit believing my doubts? What if I started thinking new thoughts? What if I hung around with new crowds? Anything I can believe, I'm a different but time is not wasting time. You want me for much more than just making a dime. Come alive and wake up, breathe in, take action. Be faithful in the little things, but that will you begin? Nothing happens by chance, I'ma take my stance. I believe I must, I will and I can be everything I'm called to be. I know because someone taught me to believe. What if I was creative? What if I would give it my best? What if I had more living in me? No telling what I do, I could change a life. What if I was creative for greatness? What if I went, gave it my best? What if I had more living in me? No telling what I do, I could change a life. Creative for greatness, I will go. don't give in my medicine. I know I have more living in me. Anything is possible to come through the least I can. Creative for greatness, I will. Don't give in my medicine. I know I have more living in me. No telling what I do. So it's just that we go through life and we have a lot of things that just blur our vision and we don't see that greatness that's inside of us until we actually get to see who he is. So he, when we see who he is, who God is, then we realize, man, I was created for so much more. There's so much more that's inside of me that I wouldn't be able to tap into until I got to know him. So that's what my main point for today is about getting to know who God is. So living. So my shirt, I designed this little design right here. It says "Live to Know Him." This from the heart, comes from the heart. Like, you just can't get to know God through a head knowledge, but you got to get to know Him through your heart. Amen. So once you get to know Him through the heart, it changes your heart. And when your heart is changed, your whole paradigm, everything about you changes. So it's getting to know Him from the heart. So that's my main point for tonight: is living to know Him. The power of knowing God is when you get to know Him. Things change. And I actually forgot my paper in the back, so I'm gonna go get it real quick. So this whole past month, I work with an organization where we establish community centers in mobile park homes, and we reach out to a lot of youth in those community centers, and we try to give them a fighting chance at life and letting them know that, hey, they can succeed. And so I work with children from elementary to middle school and high school students. And the first week in June, there was this one fifth grader. We were taking him to a night camp, and he saw the church sign that said, "Know God and make Him known." And he looks at me, he's like, "Juan, how can I make God known?" And so when he asked me that question, it hit me, and I was like, "Well, his name was Jose." I was like, "Well, Jose, let me tell you this. Let's say I'm talking to somebody and they ask about you and they want me to tell them about you. Because I know you and I spent time with you this past year, I can tell them, hey, Jose loves soccer. He knows he's getting better at it. He's a fifth grader. He's moving on to the next grade. So I can tell that person about Jose because I spent time with him and I got to know him." And I told him that's the same thing with God. You can tell other people about who God is. And you, because you spend time with him and you get to know him. Because you can't get to know somebody, you can't tell anybody about somebody who you don't know. So that's the same way with God. So when he asked that, I was like, yep, that's just how it is. You gotta spend time with that person. So it's the same thing with God. So I think the greatest call in our lives comes from the book of Jeremiah, chapter 9, verse 23 and 24. And it goes like this. "This is what the Lord says. Let not the wise boast of the wisdom, or the strong boast in their strength, or the rich boast in their riches. But let the one who boasts about this, that they have the understanding to know me, that I am the Lord who exercises kindness, justice, and righteousness on the earth. For in these I delight, declares the Lord." Amen. Who's heard that before? So if you haven't heard that, I'm going to say it again, because I think there's just so much meat in here. There's so much power in this verse. Jeremiah 29, 23 and 24. "This is what the Lord says. Let not the wise boast in their wisdom, or the strong boast of their strength, or the rich boast of their riches. But let the one who boasts about this, that they have the understanding to know me, that I am the Lord who exercises kindness, justice, and righteousness on the earth. For in these things I delight, declares the Lord." So when I was looking at this verse and I was planning on what to share with you guys and just praying about it, I just caught to the first three things that it says, that the things not to boast in. So three things not to boast in is the wisdom, strength, and riches.
And if you think about it, it's easy for us to boast about these things, about we want to talk about how smart we are, or how intelligent or better we are than other people. And we want to talk about it. We're men right here, so we got a lot of testosterone. You know, we talk about how strong we are. I saw y'all had a gym back there too. Y'all try to put on some weight and try to play somebody else. You know, and that's just a natural thing for us to do. We always want to be better than somebody else, so we want to boast about our wisdom and our strength, and talk about how also. If you're like me, I don't have that much money, so I can't boast about my riches, but. A lot of people, that's just a natural thing for people to do also, is talk about like, I got better shoes than you, or I got better clothing than you, and it may not even have to be riches, like money riches, but you also want to try to one-up somebody else, you know? So that's three things that God's like, hey, don't boast about your wisdom, don't boast about strength, don't boast about riches, but there's only one thing that he says that I want you to boast about. And I think this is where a lot of people don't really dive in any deeper, because as I said a while ago, is that we need to know God from the heart. It's not just the mind. It's not just a mind thing. Because you can read scripture, you can be around people who know God, but if the word, the scripture doesn't come into your heart, it won't really change you. You're just going to have them be more like a legalistic type of person that's like, It's just have a mindset in it, but God wants us to know from the heart. So the one thing that God wants us to boast in is understanding to know me, that I am the Lord. So he wants us to understand that he is the Lord, that he is who he says he is. Because like I said just a while ago, is that you can't know somebody unless you spend time with them. So the more that you spend time with God, one thing that's changed me a lot is spending time in worship. I love music. I learned how to play guitar. I'm not the best guitar player. I'm still learning, but I learned how to play the guitar just so that I can be able to strum the guitar and try to sing worship to the Lord by myself. And that's my way of spending time with God. And so the more that I've done that, I accepted Christ when I was 18 years old. I'm 29 right now. And so the more that I've done that, It's changed my heart, it's changed my life. And that's, I've gotten to know the presence of God. And so when I know that I'm not on the right steps, it's because I haven't spent time with him, I haven't been spending time in worship. And that's really all that God wants us to do, is to understand that understanding, to grab the understanding, to know him, that he is the Lord. And there's three things that we can get out of that too, because he says, If you're going to boast about this, boast that you have the understanding to know me, that I am the Lord who exercises kindness, who exercises kindness, justice, and righteousness on the earth. So I got a couple scriptures that I wrote down for these three things. So when you get to the understanding of God, that he is who he says he is, you understand his kindness in life. You understand who he is. So Ephesians 2:7 says, and God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, so that in the ages to come he might show the surpassing riches of his great grace and kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. So what God did for us was send Jesus on the cross for us. And he showed his kindness through that to us. Titus 3:4-6. But when the kindness of God, our Savior, and his love for mankind appeared, he saved us, not on the basis of deeds which we have done in righteousness, but according to his mercy, by washing of regeneration and renewing by the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out upon us richly through Christ our Savior. So it's nothing that we could ever do, nothing that we've ever did to earn God's love, to earn God's favor, but it's just he looked down upon mankind and said, I'm going to send my son for them. So if you ever try to earn your way to God so that you can get his love, it's not going to work like that. He says it's nothing about your good deeds, nothing about your righteousness. In Isaiah, the Bible says that our righteousness is as filthy as rags. And so it's nothing we can ever do to get up to God's good grace. But it's just through the love of Jesus and what he did for us through Christ. Psalms 36:7. How precious is your loving kindness, O God, and the children of man take refuge in the shadows of your wing. Psalm 69:16. Answer me, O Lord, for your loving kindness is good. According to the greatness of your compassion, turn to me. Psalm 63:3. Because your loving kindness is better than life, my lips will praise you. There's so many more scriptures that you can find about God's loving kindness. You can read in scriptures, but not only read in scriptures, but also experience it in your life. So when you experience it in your life, you just have this fire inside of you. You're like excited about it because you're like, man, something happened inside of me that changed me. And it's not just anything in life, but it's the God of the universe who created you. He brought you to him. And you experienced him. And so you start realizing, man, God is really kind. He's not mad at me. He doesn't dislike me. He's not against me, but he is for me. You start realizing that kindness of God. And so having the understanding that God takes brings us also to the justice part. So you understand that God is just. So let's say if you guys were, if you knew somebody that committed a terrible crime in life, and he went before a judge, and the judge just kind of waved it off, like, I'm not gonna deal with you today. Just go be free and do whatever you want. But the guy did a serious crime that said, hey, you're gonna be in for life. And do you think that's a good judge?
No.
It's not a good judge, right? So that's the same thing with God. God has to punish sin. So God, he's the just God. He brings the judgment to life. But the cool thing about it is that we don't have to have that punishment fall upon us because Jesus took that punishment.
Right.
So tonight, as I'm sharing, I'm going to be sharing a lot of what God has done in my life and a lot of scripture, because the power is in the scripture. The power is in God's word. It's not really what I say. And so God is just, and Ecclesiastes 3:17 says, I said to myself, this is King Solomon who wrote this, I said to myself, God will bring into judgment both the righteous and the wicked, for there will be a time for every activity, a time to judge every deed. Hebrews 10:3, for we know him who said, it is mine to avenge, I will repay, and again, the Lord will judge his people. So, I don't know if you ever had anybody ever do anything bad to you, anything negative to you. The awesome thing about getting to know God is it's easy to want to take it into our hands, right? We want to go and take action and be like, man, he did me wrong, and so I'm going to do my part and take him out or whatever, you know? But when you come to get to know who God is, it's like, you know what, Lord? This is what happened to me, so I'm going to release it and leave it in your hands. There's a part in the scripture where King David, who's ever heard of King David? Yeah. So King David, he sent some troops to go visit somebody, and then the guy humiliated his troops. And when King David saw his troops being humiliated when they came back to him, he was like, I'm not gonna take this. I'm gonna go and attack him, and I'm gonna take him out, basically. But then the guy's wife went to King David and said, hey, I'm sorry, please don't take this out on him. Please forgive him. Just don't go take vengeance on him. God will take vengeance for you. And so David saw that as an, he stopped and he was like, God, thank you, because you prevented me from sinning, taking matters into my own hand. And so he was like, you know what, I'm going to just let it go. And so God took care of the issue for him. And that's what God is. God is the God who avenges us. He's the God who avenges us. So he brings justice. So we looked at the kindness and we looked at God's justice. So having understanding to know him, those are two of the things. And the other thing is also righteousness. So when we get to know who God is, we know that he is righteous. 1 Corinthians 1:30 says, but by his doing, you are in Christ Jesus, who became to us wisdom from God and righteousness and sanctification and redemption. So that's what God is to us. He always does what is right. There's scripture after scripture that says that God is righteous. He does the right thing. But most of the time is that we get too anxious, we get too caught up in our feelings, that we start just trying to take matters into our own hands, and we don't actually see God at work. we get blinded, we get our vision blurred. We allow things in our hearts to overtake us. And one thing I thought about in life is that we're men, right? We're men. So we think that a lot of times we have to play the tough man role, tough man persona. And we think that we're strong. We think that we're sometimes better than other people also. And one thing that I learned is that really we're weak. We're weak. And I say that because we let our angers get the best of us. We let our anger get the best of us. We let our feelings get the best of us. And that's just so easy for us just to give into the way we feel at the very moment. Yeah, we may be physically strong, but really internally, there has to be a work, that something different has to change on the inside of us. So when I say that, there's only one way to actually to have that weakness be used in the right way, because God says that when we are weak, He is strong. When we are weak, He is strong. And we don't have to take things in all matters. So that's the awesome thing. And I'm going to keep reiterating about the understanding part to get to know who God is. Because it changes you from the inside out. It changes you. Amos 5:24 says, "But let justice roll like a river and righteousness like a never-falling stream." When we're justified, when you first accept Christ, you're justified. And God sees you just as if you have never sinned. That's justification. But sometimes you wonder, okay, if I'm justified, I accepted Christ, then that means I'm never going to sin again, which is wrong, because there's a process that of being sanctified. So you're justified. God looks at you just as if you have never sinned. He looks at you just as He looks at Christ. So He's no longer looking at you the way that you used to be. But the sanctification process is what happens throughout life, is that God is constantly working within you, and it's not just a one-time thing. It's over and over again. Even today, there's a lot of things that I realize about me. I'm like, man, I need a change inside of my heart. So I'm like, God, come in and change me. So I'm still being sanctified today. And the same thing everybody right here. Psalm 119:137, "Righteous are you, O Lord, and upright are your judgments. In these I delight, declares the Lord. In these I delight." God doesn't care how much money you have. He doesn't care how much you can bench. He doesn't care how intelligent you are. You know, He doesn't care about all this stuff. What He cares about is that you have the understanding to know Him, that He is the Lord, that He exercises kindness, He exercises righteousness, He exercises justice. That's what He wants you to know. That's what He wants from you. Micah 6:8 says, "He has shown you, O mortal, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you, to act justly and love mercy and walk humbly with your God." So that's all that God wants from you, is to walk with Him, to get to know Him, live to know Him. There's power in that. It changes your heart, it changes your mindset. There's power in that. So I mentioned King David just a while ago, and I want to read a story about from the Bible about King David. And who's ever heard of David and Goliath? David and Goliath. That's my favorite story in the Bible. And every time I look at it, I get encouraged, I get empowered. I can go back to it over and over again, and there's just so much in that. It's a cool story to me. So we pick up on 1 Samuel 17, so I'm not going to read everything, but I'm going to kind of skip through some parts of it. And 1 Samuel 17 says, "The Philistines occupied one hill and the Israelites another in the valley, with the valley between them." So this was an intense war that was going on between the Philistines and the Israelites. They were constantly at war with each other for the land of Israel. And so the Philistines were on one side, and the Israelites were on another side of the valley. And they had a champion named Goliath, who was from Gath. He came out of the Philistine camp. His height was 6 cubits and a span, which is basically 9 feet tall. So a giant, you know. Who's ever seen? Who knew Yamin from basketball? Houston Rockets. So that guy was pretty tall. So Yamin was pretty tall, and can imagine how tall Goliath was, and not only tall, but he was probably muscular, he was big. Yao Ming was skinny and tall, but Goliath was pretty big. He had a heavy armor. And so we pick up back on verse 8, it says, Goliath stood and shouted to the ranks of Israel, why do you come at me and line up for battle? Am I not a Philistine and you are not the servants of Saul? Saul was the king of Israel at that time. Choose a man and have him come down to me. If he is able to fight and kill me, we will become your subjects. But if I overcome him and kill him, he will become our subjects and serve us. Then the Philistines said, this day I defy the armies of the living God. Give me a man, let us fight each other. On hearing the Philistines' words, Saul and all the Israelites were dismayed and terrified. So those people were scared, you know. They were scared because they saw a giant. Everybody was probably like our height. And it's like going against Andre the Giant. You might like get a lick on him, but you're not gonna do any damage. Right? So he was scared. For 40 days, The Philistine came forward every morning and evening to take and took his stand. So every day he's coming at them for 40 days. He's coming and shouting, bring out a man and fight me. Bring out a man and fight me. Let him try to beat me. And when I read this, the thing that came to mind is that some of you have had a giant in your life shouting at you day after day, year after year, probably 10 years, 20 years, 5 years, telling you that you're never going to overcome. You're going to be stuck for the rest of your life. You're going to be addicted. You're going to be a drug addict. You're going to be an alcoholic. Your giant screaming at you on a daily basis saying, why do you come out to the battle line if you know you're not going to do anything? You can't overcome. Your giant screaming at you on a daily basis saying, you're not going to beat me down. You can't take me down. So the giant's coming up. So David, a young shepherd boy, he was sent by his father. This is, by this time, David, he was anointed king. He was anointed king. And the prophet Samuel, when the prophet Samuel went to the house of Jesse, he went because God told him, hey, the next king of Israel is going to be in the house of Jesse. So Jesse had 8 sons. And when the prophet Samuel went to Jesse's house, he called out each son, the oldest one to the youngest. And he kept looking at them and he's like, surely this is the next king of Israel. But God kept saying, no, he's not the next king. He's like, you keep paying attention on the outer appearance. God looks at the inward appearance. He looks at the heart. So that's, God had to correct the prophet Samuel at that time. So he went through all 7 sons and he told Jesse, he's like, is this all you have? Do you have another one? And the son, Jesse said, well, we do have another, I do have another son, but he's just a little boy, 14, 15 year old boy. So I don't know if this is gonna hit home for some of you guys, but when I read this, it kind of made me feel like Jesse was kind of overlooking his son. And a lot of us had our fathers, we probably didn't have our fathers in our lives to teach us how to become a man. A lot of us didn't have our fathers to teach us how to fix a car, how to change a tire. A lot of us didn't have a father to teach us what it's like to grow up, to mature. So David's father was kind of pushing him to the side, saying, he's just a little boy, he's probably not going to amount to anything. So I can imagine how David felt abandoned at that time, rejected by his dad. And I know this happened to a lot of us here. We all have deep wounds that are still hidden to this day. And so David was anointed king. The awesome thing about that is that God acknowledged David in front of his dad, in front of all his brothers. So his dad didn't really acknowledge him, but God anointed him king at that time. He acknowledged him. So I believe that God acknowledges us. He's looking at you guys and saying, I know you. Your earthly father may not have known you, but I have known you from the womb since I created you in your mother's womb. I know who you are. I know when you sleep at night. I know when you rise up in the morning. I know the very words that you say before you say them when they're at the tip of your tongue. So that's who God is. He knows you. And that's what he wants you to get to know him too. So David said to Saul, David went to his brother's, and he was kind of just being curious, because when you know you're a little boy, when something's going on, you're gonna be like, hey, what's going on over there? Even till today, like if something happens, like if I see policemen somewhere or like a scene, it's like I want to know the whole details. I want to know what's happening from A to Z. You know, that's how I am. So I can imagine David doing the same thing, is trying to figure out what was going on. So he's walking around, and then Saul ends up hearing about this, and Saul calls him up. But David's like, hey, let no one lose heart on account of this Philistine. You are only, so let no one lose heart on account of this Philistine. Your servant will go and fight him. So a 15, 14-year-old boy is saying, hey, I'm going to go fight him. That's kind of crazy. A giant, 9-foot giant, and a 14, 15-year-old is not possible, you know? But he's like, I'm going to go fight him. And Saul replied, you are not able to go against the Philistine and fight him. You are only a young man. He has been a warrior from his youth. So Goliath has been fighting his whole life, and he knows what it's like to fight. And David's just a young boy saying, hey, I'm going to go up against him. I'm going to go up against him. And you'll find out why here. So verse 34 says, but David said to Saul, your servant has been keeping up with his father's sheep. When a lion or a bear came and carried off a sheep from the flock, I went after it, struck it, and rescued the sheep from its mouth. When it turned to me, I seized it by its hair, struck it, and killed it. Your servant has killed both the lion and the bear. The uncircumcised Philistine will be like one of them, because he has defied the armies of the living God. The Lord who rescued me from the paw of the lion and the bear will rescue me from the hand of the Philistine. This guy was on fire, you know. He knew that God was with him when he was taking care of the sheep. He knew that God was with him whenever the lion came or the bear came and he took the sheep from the flock. That's also an impossibility. If a bear and a lion came, I'm going to run away. You know, I'm not even going to deal with that, because I'm going to die if I try to take that out of his mouth. But David knew his God. What if you knew your God? Could you beat the lion and the bear in your life? What if you knew your God? Could you have the confidence to go against your giant? David knew his God. So he said, this Philistine is going to be just like that bear, just like that lion. He's going to come out and he's going to be defeated. So Saul said to David, go and the Lord be with you. So he was like, well, this guy has confidence. So I'm like, if you want to go ahead and go. So Saul said, let go and the Lord be with you. So Saul tried putting on his armor on top of David. But David was like, I can't do this, man. I can't do this. And so he took off Saul's armor. And sometimes I think we try to put on so many other things. We try to put on, go to different places to find our comforts, to beat our giants. We try to do. We try to get high, or we try to drink a little just to get away from our giants for a little bit. Or you find a friend who's trying to just drag you back into your lifestyle, and then you gotta realize that, hey, I can't do this. I'm not gonna battle my giants like this anymore. So David said, I cannot go in these. He said to Saul, because I am not used to them. And he took them off. Then he took his staff in his hand, chose 5 smooth stones from the stream, put them in his pouch of the shepherd's bag, and with the sling in his hand, he approached the Philistine. So this is crazy to me. I read the story, and it's like he approached the Philistine. A 14, 15-year-old boy approached a giant, a 9-foot giant. He's going straight to him. He's not backing away. And remember this, that the whole army of the Israelites who had training, who knew what it's like to hold a sword, who knew what it's like to fight, they were afraid. But this shepherd boy who'd never been in war before, he goes to the battle. He goes to face the Philistine. And meanwhile, the Philistine with the shield bearer in front of him, he keeps coming closer to David. He looks at David and he sees that he's just a little boy. He's just a little boy, but he sees him going, but he despises him. He said to David, am I a dog that you come to me with sticks? Am I the Philistine cursed by David? And the Philistine cursed David by his gods. "Come here," he said, "and I'll give your flesh to the birds and wild animals." So he was being threatened. The Philistine was threatening him. David said to the Philistine, "You come against me." I want you guys to hear this part right here. This is what David said. "You come against me with the sword and the spear and the javelin, but I come to you in the name of the Lord Almighty, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied." You come to me with the sword, you come to me with the spear, you come to me with the javelin, but I come to you in the name of the Lord God Almighty. This is the name that I come to you in. David didn't have a sword. He had just five smooth stones. That's what in the slingshot. He looked at the possibilities of who's going to win that battle. The giant's going to win because he has the sword. He's 9 foot tall, covered in armor. A young man, a 15-year-old, with just stones and a slingshot. But he had the confidence because he knew his God. He had the responsibilities of taking care of the sheep. God protected him, saved him and the sheep from the paw of the bear, the paw of the lion. And that Philistine's going to be the same way. So he tells him, "This day the Lord will deliver you into my hands. I will strike you down. I will cut off your head. This day I will give you the carcasses of the Philistines to the armies of the birds and the wild animals, and the whole world will know that there is a God in Israel. And all those gathered here will know that it is not by the sword, it is not by the spear or the javelin that the Lord saves. For the battle is the Lord's, and he will give all of you into our hands." So it's not by the sword, it's not by the hand. Zechariah says that in chapter 14, it says that it is not by power nor by strength, but it's by my spirit, says the Lord. So David had that in his heart. It's by the spirit of the Lord. The battle is the Lord's. So it doesn't matter. Come at me with a sword. Come at me with a spear. I'm still going to defeat you. So we can say that to our giants in our life today. You keep coming at me with every tactic that you have, but because I know my God, I know my Lord, I will do great things. I will not let you beat me down. Enough is enough. Enough is enough. As the Philistine moved closer to attack him, David ran towards the battle line to meet him. Again, he ran towards the battle line. A young boy ran towards the battle line. Reaching into his bag and taking out a stone, he slung it and struck the Philistine on his forehead. The stone sank into his forehead and he fell on his face up to the ground. What are the odds, you know? And I don't know what kind of helmet he had, but what I heard is that his helmet covered everything in his head, except like a little small area on the forehead. So he threw the stone, he swung it, and hit him right in the forehead. It's a one-hit kill shot. You know, it's like, y'all play Call of Duty before? Hit kill shot, you know? So he took him out with just a slingshot. But he didn't stop there. David ran towards him, stood over him, and took his own sword and cut off his head. So what did David say earlier? He said, "This day I'm going to take you down, and I'm going to cut off your head." So he went after it. He went towards it. He went for it. With the confidence of knowing his God. He went for it. He went for it. So when the Philistines saw their hero was dead, they turned and they ran. The men of Israel and Judah pursued the Philistines, and they went after them. So a young shepherd boy defeated their giant. And because of that, the whole army went and started pursuing their enemies. So, what if you overcame in your life? What if you beat your giants? Imagine how many other people that will free you up to say, "Man, because he did it. Because he did it. I can do it. Because he did it." Revelation 19:10 says that the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. So when somebody shares a testimony about Jesus, what Jesus has done in their life, it's like you're prophesying over somebody and saying that, "Hey, you also are going to overcome in the Lord. Because you get to know Jesus, you're going to overcome." So the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. Romans 15:4 says that, "For everything that was written in the past was written to teach us, so that through the scriptures, it teaches us endurance, and encouragement, so that we can have hope." So everything that I'm reading today, it's not just reading just to have, so you guys can have a good story and see about a young man killing a giant and helping out his army. It's so that you can also have the encouragement, have the endurance, and have the hope that God provides for us. Because those who hope in God will not be put to shame. Those who hope in God will not be put to shame. So my story, I'll share with y'all my story. So I was born in Mexico. I was raised in Odis, Dallas, Texas. And my parents brought me at a young age. I was undocumented and he was an illegal immigrant. My dad got deported when I was 14. My mom had to go back to Mexico because her father was passing away. So I was on my own. I got kicked out at 15 from my cousin's boyfriend's house where I was living in at that time. House hopping, going from place to place, just in survival mode, trying to figure out how to survive, how to live, what I was gonna do with my life. In those moments, I had church ministries reach out to me in my neighborhood, inviting me to their church services. They taught me about Jesus. They taught me about the gospel. They taught me about what Jesus did for me on the cross and who he is. And I was going through services even though I was house hopping, I just kept making an effort to keep going to church on a daily basis because I felt the love. I felt something different. I felt like I belonged somewhere. And so the more I kept going back, I kept learning scripture. I kept learning, getting to know people who knew God, and it changed my life at that time. But I didn't truly accept Jesus in my heart until I was 18 years old. I was living at a friend's house. I was in a small little closet room, and I got to a point where I was like, man, I've had it. I'm done with life. And I cried out to God. I turned on some worship music, and I didn't care at that time if anybody came in and saw me crying and praying, because I knew that something had to change inside of me. So I prayed August 26, 2008. Around 11 o'clock at night, I stayed up for like 3 hours praying. I was like, God, I'm sick of living life my own way. I'm tired of having to go from house to house, place to place, not knowing if I'm gonna have food to eat or a place to stay. Not knowing if I'm gonna if I'm gonna be able to see my parents ever again. And I said, I'm sick of it. I surrender. I give you my life. In Jesus' name, I give you my heart. And I don't know exactly what happened. I can't tell you what happened, but I woke up the next day, August 27th. Because I had poured out my heart to God in prayer, and I woke up the next day, I just felt light. I felt new. Something happened on the inside of me that changed me. That's why I have this passion here. This is why I'm here today, because I want you guys to know the promises of God. Amen. I want you guys to know that the God that changed me, he can change you too. This is why I'm passionate. This is the message that I want everybody to know that I come in contact with. He can do it. He can do it. So that night, I surrendered my life to God. The next day, like I said, I woke up. I was different. Something happened on the inside of me. I just couldn't explain it. And I remember talking to my mom on the phone, and she was like, so how are you feeling? And she had no idea what had happened to me. But I could just... When she asked me that question, I just knew that something was different. So I started making decisions that just kind of led me to get to know God more. I started getting involved in the church, at a different church. I started going to a men's Bible study on Saturday mornings. I was 18, 19 years old. Everybody else was over 30 years old. And it's because I was hungry. I was hungry. I wanted to change. I wanted something different in life. So those things changed my life, because I hung around men who knew God. They helped me prepare. Fast forward to 2015, November 2015, I got permission to go to Mexico, and I saw my parents for the first time in over 11 years.
Amen.
And I seen God do things for me over and over again that I couldn't do myself. Amen. I seen God do things through me that I couldn't do myself. And now I think about the times that God could have done so much more through me if I was just completely surrendering my heart to Him at different moments in time. I found out that it it wasn't just a one-time thing where I had to surrender my heart. It wasn't only on August 27, 2008. Even till this day, I have to kneel down before God and say, God, I can't do this. I'm nothing without you. Jesus says that he's the vine and we're the branches. Cut off the branch from the vine, and it's lifeless. Right. Same thing with us. If we're cut off from him, we're lifeless. This is what he wants from you, is that you stay connected to him, that you get to know him. See, just I realized that just by me sharing my testimony, I was always so excited to share. I used to go to downtown Dallas to talk to people because something happened to me, I changed, you know. I felt the power of God in my life, so I would constantly go and share my testimony with people and say, hey, can I talk to you, and just talk to them about the Lord. But I realized that my testimony is not really what's going to change you guys. It's by you having an encounter with God. It's by you opening up your heart and saying, God, I accept you. God, I take you in my heart. Today, tomorrow, the next day, the day after that, next week, next year, year after that, whenever you're 80 years old, every day, you keep encountering him. The more you get closer to him, the more you feel him, the more you realize that he is here. I'm not abandoned. I'm not alone. I'm not rejected. I'm not going to be disappointed. Live to know him from the heart. My favorite scripture is Psalm 9, verse 10. Psalm 9, verse 10. And it says that those who know your name will put their trust in you, because you, Lord, have never forsaken those who seek you. That's power, man. Amen. That's power. Those who know your name will put their trust in you, because you, Lord, never forsake those who seek you.
Amen.
There's some, God, I don't know if you realize, but God has so many names. God has so many names. And it's a name specifically to every situation that we're dealing with in life. Mm. Psalm 46:1 says that you are ever-present help in the time of trouble. Mm. He's an ever-present help in the time of trouble. Then Psalm 9:10 is a promise. That's a promise to me. I take that deep to heart. Because if you get to know his name, you can put your trust in him. As I said earlier, you cannot trust somebody you don't get to know. You can't trust somebody you don't get to know. And he doesn't forsake those who continue to seek him. He hasn't forsaken you. He knows where you're at. He knows where you're standing. He knows you're here today because you want that change in your heart. I was talking to what's your name again?
DJ,
yeah. I was talking to DJ when we were eating lunch, and he told me something that just struck my heart, and I was like, yes, that's really what I want people to say when it comes to programs like this. He was like, man, I came here just to get clean, but he's like, I found God.
Right,
yeah,
bro.
You know. That's the power right there. I found God. I found Jesus. He won't forsake you as you keep seeking after him. So God has so many names. So Jesus referred to God as Father over and over again. Countless times he kept calling him Father. So God is a father to the fatherless. If you haven't had your father in life, I missed out on my dad when I was 14. I had him all the way until I was 14. And from that moment on, I had to grow up without him. I was able to talk to him on the phone every once in a while as a teenager, but he wasn't there. I didn't have him to teach me certain things. So I had to look for that father figure in different places. I found different men that I allowed in my life to teach me different things. There was one time, my youth pastor, I was probably 19 years old, and I was trying to raise money to go to a program, to a ministry program, Bible 6-month Bible program. And he had told me to not do something that I ended up doing. And so he looked at me, he was frustrated with me, but he was like, he just looked at me in the eye, and he was like, listen to your daddy. And that struck a chord with me, because it was easy for me to call other women mom. Because I could see other women who were mother figures to me, and I could call them mom. Because I didn't have my mom with me either. So I'd be like, hey, mom, mama. But but I could never call another man dad. I just couldn't do it. And so whenever he got down like to my eye level, he was like, listen to your daddy. It took like a split second for me to realize that he was calling himself my dad, which he had been acting like a father to me. And in a split second, I was like, I can either punch him in the face. No, like literally, I was like, I can either just like punch him in the face or just take this in, because I don't have a father besides him right now. And that's how God was showing me that he was a father to me. That's how God was showing me that he was a father to me. That's a name that he has. He's a father. Yahweh, the self-existent one. Adonai, the Lord of the God who is Lord of all. Jehovah Mekadesh, the Lord who sanctifies you. Jehovah Rohi, the Lord your shepherd. Jehovah Shammah, the Lord who's present. Jehovah Rapha, the Lord who heals. Jehovah Sikkenu, the Lord our righteousness. Jehovah Jireh, the Lord who provides. Jehovah Nisi, the Lord our banner. Jehovah Shalom, the Lord our peace. Jehovah Shabbat, the Lord of hosts, the God of angel armies. Jehovah Malet, the God of recompense. Elohim, God is creator. El Elyon, the Most High God. You can go on and on and on. There's so many names. I learned a lot of these names this past 10 years, and I take those to heart. I realize that the more that I've gotten to know him, like Psalm 9 verse 10 says, I can put my trust in him. I can put my trust in him. You can put your trust in him. You get to know him. You get to know him. I think the most important name of all those is that God came with is Jesus. The name of Jesus. When the angel went to Mary, the Virgin Mary, he said, you're going to have a son, and you will call him Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins. That was the meaning of Jesus. He will save the people from their sins. So that's what, and when you get to know Jesus, you get to know who he is. You get to know the reason that he came on earth. He came to live the life that we couldn't live, died the death that we deserved, rose up 3 days later for us. So because he rose from the grave, we have a living hope. On that cross, he nailed everything that was written against us. Every single thing that we have done in life that we deserve death over, he nailed that to the cross. He nailed that to the cross. So there's power in the name of Jesus, power in the cross. So we don't have to live governed by our sin. We don't have to live governed by our thoughts, because Jesus took it. And like I read earlier from Titus, is that it's not by our righteousness, it's not by anything that we have ever done, but it's by the love of God through Christ Jesus and what he came to do for us. What he came to do for us. He did that for us on the cross. See, the cross requires a change. It demands a change. Because you can't come to God the same way. And the thing is that you don't have to change yourself. All you gotta do is just lay it all at the foot of the cross. I believe in Jesus, you did it. I'm no longer gonna carry this baggage again. Unforgiveness, and you can think of anything, fill in the blank. I'm no longer gonna carry this pain that I hold in my heart. So, right now, there's an opportunity for you guys to surrender your heart to the Lord. For you guys just to say, Jesus, I surrender my heart to you. Jesus said that no one can come to the Father unless God draws him near. We can come to God anytime. We can come to God in prayer, but there's a specific drawing moment that God is calling you to, and it's to salvation. Mm. You feel that tug in your heart. You feel something inside of you tugging you and saying, I need to step into it. I no longer want to be the same. And you know if you feel, you've been feeling that tonight, that God is tugging your heart and say, hey, I'm knocking on the door today. Open up your heart. Let me in. I'm knocking. Jesus said, whoever acknowledges me before men, I will also acknowledge them before my Father. If you deny me before men, I will deny you before my Father. So I don't know where your walk is with God today. I don't know if you accepted Christ before, or if you're just still new to hearing about who Jesus is. But I know that he's calling you to a deeper relationship. And if you go deep, he's still calling you to go deeper and deeper. Deeper still. So if you want, I'm going to challenge you today. If you want to accept Christ in your heart, I'm going to ask you to stand up. Take a stand and say, and just pray with me and say, God, I want you in my heart. Appreciate you. So as I pray, I want you to pray in your heart and say, Jesus. I want you to pray in your heart. But I'm going to take just another second, because I know there's a couple more too here that just feel that tug in the heart and saying, hey, God is knocking on your door. He's knocking on your heart. He's knocking on your heart. He's calling on you. I'm asking not to miss this opportunity either. He's calling you today. Father, I thank you so much for your goodness. Thank you for your kindness. I thank you that you are a God in heaven. Thank you for the reminder of that you love us and you care for us, and you're not looking at us with condemning eyes. You're not just sitting on your throne and saying, you did this again, you did that again. I remember when you did this several years ago. But you're looking at us and you're saying, Jesus took that for you. You no longer have to carry the weight by yourself. You no longer have to carry the pain, the anxieties, the burdens, the cares, your addictions. So God, right now at this moment, Lord, we just surrender our heart to you. We pray, God, that our hearts would just be knitted to yours, that we live to know you, so that we can know exactly what it's like to overcome our giants, just like King David did. That he stood in front of his giant and he faced them and he knocked them down. I pray, God, that we have that same boldness, because we come in the name of the Lord, not in our own things, not in our own mindsets, not in our own strength, not in our own might, but because it's by your Spirit. Thank you for each and every man that's here. God, I just pray that you continue to do the work in their hearts that you started within them, because your word says that you will complete the work that you started in each person. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Appreciate you guys.
Thank you.
Actually, I was gonna do a song after I shared my testimony, but I got in the spirit. I can still do it right now if y'all want me to.
Yes, of course.
So this one's called "Sweet Surrender," and it kind of goes along with my testimony, and it's "Sweet Surrender" for a reason, because there's a line, some lyrics that I put in there that I said that I never knew real freedom until I gave in surrender. So real freedom comes when I truly surrender my life to God. You wish, babe.
He saved me from my plight and gave me new insight. Caught an overnight delivery. He came to me quickly, packaged it preciously. Humbly, here I come. Again, I hand over submitting to the Son. I can't keep my composure, sir. Come unto the Father, knowing Christ, there is no other. Draw my heart up to worship, knowing I am blood purchased.
Bought you with a price, it was worth the wait. Now with my Son in right, shall we in your pain?
Because your grace bestowed, how dare I let it go? I told, there's a fire that burns deeply within on my soul. I pray to God. God you know. Receive his beauty, behold, give him the body to hold. He's not here to condemn, but he is coming to restore. Making new than before, giving to surrender. Tell him I am yours,
your surrender. All you done, I will remember.
Until I gave in surrender. Now all my hope and dreams to God will not render. Bring the storm with the thunder. He's become my living hope. No depression shall exceed. He's my new way to cope. Every care, every struggle, every worry that I face, I'm not scared of the rumble. I've been covered by grace.
I've been covered by grace.
Come on.
I trust in your word.
Yeah.
God, please make haste to all my reward.
I can walk in confidence. Surrender, so I dance.
I'm free. You said we're free, I'm free. You said we're free.
Hey, I can walk in confidence. So surrender, so I dance.
I'm free. You said we're free, I'm free. You said we're free.
I can walk in confidence. So surrender, so I dance. I surrender, sweet surrender.
I am yours, sweet surrender. And all you've done. Looking for me,
come on.
Oh, sweet surrender.
Hey, freedom never tasted so sweet.
Freedom never tasted so sweet. Freedom never tasted so sweet.
Come on, take a hold of it.
Take hold of this freedom.
Yeah. Hey.
I am your sweet surrender. And all you've done.
Interesting. You guys can come get one up here. I appreciate y'all.